First of all, for this wonderful introduction. My name is Josip Stepanić, and I am professor of the Faculty of Mechanical Engineering and Naval Architecture in Zagreb. Before I start, let me thank the organizers for inviting me to this summer school, and I thank you for your participation on this school. But this lecture will not proceed spontaneously. It will need our efforts to raise its full goals. So any lecture, as you probably saw recently in internet, can be treated in several ways. And I hope that in this lecture, by our common efforts, you will be given the basics of system dynamics. What is system dynamics? Of course, in detail we will cover that later. But for the moment, let me just state that it is one powerful method for simplifying a bit by bit complex systems without losing any part of it. That will, I hope, be our starting point, which we use, you will use in further work. And for this lecture to be rather efficient, I hope that we will all cooperate, that the cooperation will not be one emergent phenomenon that will become true, say, about 11 o'clock after first coffee break, but that we will cooperate from the very beginning. So in case that you have some comments, questions, remarks, just state them, don't wait that I ask you, do you have some comments? We have several chapters in this presentation to cover. Some of them will be before the coffee break, some of them will be after the coffee break. So before the coffee break, one could say it will be the boring part, that it will consist of lectures. And after coffee break, we will have workshops, so we will be divided into several groups. And I hope that from Sunday and Monday, that you divided yourself spontaneously into several groups so that we can then proceed with virtual with teamwork. Now, these chapters are something which will be self-describable, and because we are at the university, and every university is known to have a lot of exams, and every decent student always talks about exams and professors, but from the other point of view, then we will start with one simple example. Do you agree? Okay. So we have one simple question, and I would like to ask you to think about that and to solve that problem. So the exam is less than one sentence. And the first task that you should solve is find a solution. In other words, what letters should be put on this line so that the sentence when read in one line will become true. Okay, so you can start solving the problem. You can use pencil, paper, count. 1, 2, 3. Try.
Many letters.
Many letters. Okay. Great. Can we have more precise solution?
More than one.
Okay. Yes. Yes. Great. In fact, that is a test whether you are awake. Awakened person should, in a minute, solve the problem. If I counted well, 36 is one answer. When you write 36, THI and so on, then it is exactly 36 letters. Okay, so that is the solution. Let us find, now when we solved the problem and found one solution, let us proceed. We were successful. So let us proceed and find another solution. I heard we have several solutions already. Can we have one qualitative different solution? Of course we can, so we will state it loud and clear. Well, another solution would be to write this sentence contains something like colleagues stated before, but purposefully I will write it in some different manner. This letter sentence contains, say, 5 plus how many? 30 letters. Because plus and 30 are not letters, so they are not counted as letters. And you can put this number so that when counted, when letters are counted, everything is right. Now, when we found this solution, then we can straightforwardly solve the last problem. So that is the last part of this example. Can we find infinite number of solutions? Of course we can. We just use this number 30 and write it differently. Say 20 plus 10, 40 minus 10. And we obtain a myriad of solutions. So can we proceed with that example? Okay, so that is one simple introduction, which I will refer to later in this presentation. When we proceed with our lecture, then we will introduce a lot of notions, which I hope most of them are well known to you and you used them previously, but it is good that we put them in one slide and that we use some basic description for the notions. So we will use the word innovation from the very title of this school and in later examples. Then ideas, which is one broader notion than innovation. One can refer to information when talking about ideas. Then we will see that it is not in some vacuum, in some mental space or whatever, but that we have one environment which in very subtle and a lot of ways, in fact, influences the realizations of innovation and other previously mentioned notions. Spontaneously we will come to the notion of system regarding to that, and in the second part of this lecture I will give you more details, notions like emergence and adaptation. So let us discuss some of these notions for the moment. So innovation is development of new products and services that brings about change. Now, I will not say change and hope, which other persons previously spoke in different words for different purposes. I will just say that innovation brings about change. Whether that change is for good or for bad, well, every innovation is introduced to bring about some good change, some improvement, some better state than was previously established, but we will see that the general dynamics of complex systems can bring about, after good change, some bad changes. And in fact, our first example will be example of that discrepancy between short-term improvement and longer-term degradation of the system. Innovation, in that sense, is one specific part of ideas. Ideas are broadly described as constant mental representations, and innovations are their realizations in some specific environment for the purpose of specific system. Information is usually treated technically as a quantitative variable, which can be measured in bytes or terabytes nowadays. And regarding to ideas, information is usually quantitative, meaningful part of information. We can also have another notion regarding that, it is data, data. So information is one specific part of data which have meaning in some system. Now, these notions can be defined in different ways, so that is why I spend some time describing them, just to be sure that we all have a common approach to these notions. If you have some different definitions, we can discuss them now or later. Environment and system, I will speak for the moment. And emergence is one notion that I already used when I was talking about our cooperation. So that is initial phase of some later, broader, larger change in the system. Emergent phenomena or emergence is something which starts as a small spark and then the fire starts from that spark. Now that fire, to proceed with that metaphor, and then therefore the also can be controlled or uncontrolled. So that spark, emergent phenomena, can bring about improvement of the system or its degradation or collapse. And adaptation is one process which is closely related to innovations, environment and systems, and we will see later how innovations improve our adaptation of system to our environment. Now, in these several minutes, I managed to introduce a lot of words, theoretical constructs, so that may be rather abstract. And I hope that after these two examples, these notions will be clarified and will not be so abstract as maybe they are now. Two textbook examples for innovations, for complex systems, for system dynamics, for system thinking, for everything. It's maybe harder to think some words for which these two examples are not good examples of. First example is a historical example of Kaiba deers, and the second example is about scurvy. Do we all know what is scurvy? So that is one illness which severs in 18th, 17th, 16th century. And what is Kaibab? Does anybody know? Kaibab is one region in northern Arizona, in the United States, which is, I think, a national park. At least it is protected area, and it looks probably something like that. So this is not a picture of Kaibab, this is just one picture of a nice scenery, and some animals, deers, eating the grass there, and living the grass. So, something very nice. And similar situation was, I think, in 1905, seen by the President Roosevelt in the Kaiba, in Arizona, when he visited that area. It was written that about 4,000 deer was the population of the herd of deer found there in 1905, and the capacity of the whole region, capacity measured and taken into consideration the vegetation, the climate, the region, the water, was estimated to be much larger, say about 30,000. And because it was very nice situation, almost a paradise, it was prescribed by the president, so nobody, not by anybody, but by himself, the president, to introduce additional protection measures to protect this herd of animals. That measures included a lot of measures, but they considered that other people living in the neighborhood were not allowed to come into Kaiba free by their will to hunt animals. And then rangers and other patrols were introduced to protect the this herd of animals, kind of deer, from other wild and domestic animals, because they eat grass, so there will be no grass for the kind of deer. Why was that so? Because that kind of population was population of very good fitness animals. And that measures bring recently to 1905, very fast, tremendous success. This initial about 4,000 population herd enlarged soon, and year by year, number of deer in Kaibab herd augmented. Because of the measures introduced by such an authority as the president, then the Kaibab situation became well known, so you probably heard for the writer Zane Grey, who wrote one novel in which he referred to the custom that became introduced by rangers in that area, that they rode the deer while riding close to them. So they jumped to deer and rode them. So that example from one animal, one population, one region, treatment of one region, became known in a lot of other disciplines, in literature, in popular life. And along with the measures which I previously described, a lot of statistics were initiated. So the records state that in 1920, 15 years after the visit by President to that region, first deer died because of starvation, and probably it in that time was written just to writer, some administrator, can prove that he earns his pay. Nobody, as is known from the available data, took some new measures and introduced new efforts to see whether that is one emergent phenomenon, spark of the future trend, or just one event. Several years after that, 1924, in that region occurred a massive death of deer caused by starvation. So the whole population of deer went to one catastrophic event. That triggered a lot of additional attention of other people. So by one scientist, Leopold, I will use understanding which we all population gathered from his work and work of other persons when they analyzed what in fact happened there. It all went well from 1905, almost 2 decades, and then suddenly a chorus appeared. Why was that so? What happened? Something new and fast and of high intensity must have happened when after almost 20 years of success, suddenly collapse occurred. Well, at the end of the development of our understanding of that topic, we obtained new insight, a lot of models, initiation of whole set of ecological modeling, and understanding that in fact, from the very beginning in 1905, it was kind of prescribed that sometime later, nobody knew whether that would be 20 years or so, sometime later, tremendously different event will happen, a collapse. So, let us cover that words with one graph. On the horizontal axis we see year, 1905, so 1906 when the measures start to be conducted, 1910, 1915, 1920, 1924, beginning of the collapse, and later years, of course. And on the vertical axis we see the deer population in thousands, so 25,000, 50,000, up to approximately 100,000. Initial population was estimated to be 4,000. And we see that really in the beginning, the population enhanced year by year. Not just that it was raised in number, but it was accelerated. So the rise itself rose. We have accelerated rise of the population in the first several years. And then collapse. This thick red line is one approximation of this obtained data. One specific point here is approximately year 1920. Formal mathematically on that graph, we can state that it is a point of inflection. And it divides two regions. First region with clear and accelerated rise. So, from the introduction of deer protection measures, for the next 15 years, we have accelerated rise. If we can, if we want to be more formal, then we would say exponential rise. Everything rises, number of deer is larger year by year. And after that inflection point, we still obtain some rise in the population, but it is not so tremendously accelerated as in previous years. So the rise exists, but it is slower than previous. And on that peak, we cover with that a second region with the collapse of population. Now we can model that in some details and quantitatively model that, and analysis of that event, of that sequence of events, we want to say so, wrote about some quantitative models. I will refer to them soon. But for the moment, after that short story, let me repeat somewhat, in somewhat more precise manner, what was just stated. So some measures were established for the rotation of the herd, but they brought about unexpected consequences, besides the collapse of the population. There is one system, the Kaibab region, and deer of Kaibab region, and it has some relation among its elements, and that relations are rather complex. As you remember the slide of Professor Markov, there are a lot of relations in elements of one complex system. And that complexity and the number itself of relations made reliable predictions hard. So what was straightforwardly, seemingly the only good solution, introduction of protection measures, in fact, after some delay, brought about consequences which were not predicted. As a rule, what can be inferred from this one particular example, but which is example by example, as a rule, we have many times in complex systems delay of full set of consequences of some changes that we introduced in the system. Either that we introduced them or which occurred by some other reason. This is because these relations among elements are non-linear. So growth is non-linear, decline is non-linear, and that non-linearity takes some time to raise its full amount. We people are used to think in a linear way. So year by year, we will get 10% by 10% of something more or less, and that is linear kind of thing. But the processes in reality, in nature, in society, so realistic processes, are not linear. They can be treated in a linear way in some short time sequences. But if we want to have processes treated in some either not so short time sequences, not so short durations, then we usually deal with non-linearities. And non-linearities are rather hard to be dealt with. So people from early history to more recent history, tried and successfully developed some methodologies and lot of set of measures that helps us to deal with complex systems and their non-linear nature. From time to time, I will use some proverbs, which in a qualitative, which is non-quantitative way, in fact show that our ancestors maybe did not understand as we do nowadays, but surely took into account these non-linearities and these drastic changes. Okay, after that example, let us now remember that we are in the summer school related to innovations. So let us see whether there is some innovation which can be analyzed in this example of Kaidō. So let us discuss what is innovation is this in this example. So that is my question to you. What was the innovation seen in that example of Kaidō? I don't have your list, so I cannot call you by your names. If you agree, I will ask first by second by first. Until we come to the last of you, and then we repeat the sequence. Do you know each other? Then when I ask you something, I would like that you say your name and surname so that I remember you and you each other remembers each other. Okay, but Colin, you can you state what is innovation in this example?
First
I
need to say the name.
Yes. Loud and clear so that everybody hears.
Okay, my name is Jelena and I came from Zagreb. And I think the innovation in this example was that measures that they strict the place where the...
So the set of measures?
Yes.
In fact, the rules?
Yes.
So their rules, their introduction, was innovation. And it certainly brought about a change, a drastic change. Okay, how was that innovation communicated? Do we all understand what communication means in that context? So communication, somebody wrote about, thought of that innovation, of that rules, and they needed to be communicated with other persons, with local population, with rangers, with other services, with administrators. So, how was that innovation communicated? What do you think?
Okay, I'm Anya. I'm from University of Ljubljana. I studied business there. And if you just explain how to communicate, I guess they introduced that set of rules and talked about it to the locals. And I don't know how it's communicated to the environment. They introduced some
So from one central authority, the rules and knowledge of rules spread level by level to whole population of humans, of course. Okay. Then next question: what was the time span of that innovation?
My name is Marina. I am coming from Zagreb, also from University College Nikola Šubić-Zrinski. I think that the time span was 20 years, from 1920s to 1930s.
You call it, do you agree with that?
My name is Carmen and I'm from the University of Zagreb. I have been doing some economics.
I agree, yes, or I don't agree.
President, in order in 1905.
Okay, the rules are this kind of tricky question, because really, after first, second, and third years, in a very short time period, the consequences of measures introduced there, like the innovation communicated throughout the system and implemented, was clearly seen. But the whole set of consequences also included the co-ops which occurred 20 years later. So it is kind of a tricky question that we cannot answer clearly and uniquely in every example of an introduction of some innovation. It all is related to that rectangles. What do we treat as our time span? Do we want to see some consequences or all consequences in some shorter or longer time period? One can say, but wait, we have another third rectangle, or fourth, whatever, which brought about new consequences of the same set of rules introduced here. Yes, that can be the case, and it depends on the precise model that we have when we analyze. Okay, so time span can be defined with having in mind that we must take into account some finite set of consequences which we relate to that innovation. And what system or members of some system adopted that innovation? Can you answer that question?
My name is Philip and I came from University of Monaco. What I mean is the beginning of the
research. Okay. Then you go again.
You think it's clear, I think all the people that were involved, so from the institutions, they had to adapt a new way of rules and work. And then the people who were living there, if they were included, we don't know this, they didn't explain this.
Sorry, I didn't hear your last part.
I said that you didn't explain if the people who were living there were included or not. They just were forced to accept the rules. It doesn't mean that they really accepted them. So we don't know these facts.
Maybe they were not happy with them, but they I think they surely followed it. Okay, what about the animals? Did they adapt to the innovation? They had to, nobody asked them. The wolves, which were not allowed by fences or rangers and their guns to take some deer. Okay, so a lot of members adopted, either by their free will or by force, that innovation. So we have some more topics to discuss about that innovation. Okay, now we clarified what was the innovation, have some rather vague, but it is better than nothing. Time span of that innovation in our minds and other characteristics of that innovation. So let us see, was there a relative advantage that these rules introduced in the system? Okay, they brought about change. Was there advantage of change? Well, the purpose of their introduction was to protect the animals, and the raise of number of the population of deer was proof that we have advantage with that innovation. So, in the first several years after 1905, the innovation that is introduction brought about clear advantage. Was that innovation compatible with the system's norms? System we are talking about. Let us concentrate on the human part of that system. Because measures were prescribed, followed, and implemented by humans. So, who is next to continue? conversation and discussion.
My name is Tara. I came from the University of Marburg. It was
partial. Yes. Because probably administration thought the system norms are enhanced with that preservation of animals. While probably some of local population considered the others, some different. But we can say that, at least I guess, everything should be verified with precise data, but by rule of thumb, let us say that the majority of members of the human system involved thought that introduced rules are compatible with the other norms. Was that innovation complicated?
My name is Nicolas, and I'm from France. From the human point of view, I think not so much, but we don't take care. We don't take care of all the characteristics that we should when we implement the innovation.
So it was straightforwardly understood by every person involved what does that rules mean? What mm-hmm. So it was not complicated?
Yeah, the rules no, but the reality a bit more.
So the rules were in fact for the common people, you cannot hunt the deer, you cannot take your cows there, nothing. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Understood. Okay. Was that innovation trouble? Well, that is maybe one question which needs some clarification. What does trability mean? That means, can we experiment in some small part of the system with that innovation and see if that is good for that subsystem, small part of our system, then we will implement it in the whole system. Well, this innovation was trouble, but it was not the case in history. It was from the very beginning but just let us know that trackability is one interesting and many times important characteristic of innovations. And the last question for discussion, were the innovation effects observable? It is a too easy question to be discussed, so we can clearly answer it. Yes, they were pretty much observable from the first year after their introduction.
I have some other question about the first one. When you ask the relative advantages for the innovation, my question is how we find out as human society that more deers will be better? Why 4,000 will be was not enough?
Yes, that is a very good question. And in fact, it cannot be answered uniquely within an answer which is valid everywhere, every time.
Mm-hmm.
It depends on the previous and its tendencies. So some people maybe wanted to see no deers there. Some people thought that there are 4,000 too many animals there. It depends on the system, its norms, it works.
Yeah, I mean, they decided to implement this innovation because they saw that population was going down and they was afraid, or they just wanted to do something good for ecology and they learned this.
It was not going down, it was rather stationary with some small fluctuations in the previous years, of course. As it was not documented in previous years, we can just guess from some common occurrences of this kind of this in literature. But
a fantasy of natural zone.
Kind of paradise.
And at the beginning of the presentation, you wrote that the maximal population that estimated was 30,000.
Yes.
Why the society didn't react when they saw that we approached this level, or we already are near the maximum?
Yes. And really, that is one very deep and interesting question. So let me ask collectively that question. Why was that not the case? When it was seen that the population of the animals was larger than biological maximum, 30,000.
Only 10 years later.
Yes. Why didn't people stop to conduct these measures?
Reduce, I don't know. Or reduce the protection.
Yes, yes. Or introduce additional rules.
Yeah.
Yes, why was that? Yes.
Maybe they couldn't predict what is going to happen because of all kinds of influences from the outside as well, like nature and the food that these animals ate and stuff like that.
Yes.
And maybe they couldn't predict what is going to happen. That it's going to continue to change.
Yes, I think that is correct. But now, one digression. After the coffee break, please let us all sit in the first two or three rows. So that we hear each other better and that we can see each other better. Yes.
I just want to notice that in some park in northwest of Italy, they take care of wolves now, and they control like every year, every month, how many wolves. And if there are any space for them for living and everything, it's more and more proof, but not so much, not like this example. They take care that the population grows slowly, constantly, and us enough to survive.
Yes, we have hundreds of 10 per emissions per annual treatment of these wolves. Yes, yes. But it is now this.
Yes.
After this and other similar examples,
mm-hmm.
after formulation of the whole new area of ecological modeling,
mm-hmm.
when people get an understanding that nothing can be different. And my answer to your question would be that effect of flocking or herding occurred. So it went good for the 10 years. Why should we stop? Or to state the question in another way. Who would start it? The rules were introduced by authority. It was implemented, they were implemented by the whole system.
Mm-hmm.
So who would be led to say, no, it is not good? Maybe there were some people thinking that it cannot be good for humanity. Like we said, we have a lot of people who look on our present situation and say, oh, it can't last for eternity. But we thought that not so loud. So it takes a lot of courage and arguments, which were not existing at that time, to say it will bring about bad consequences. Road to hell is covered with good intentions. So it really deserves some courage and arguments to say that good intentions were introduced by the whole system will bring something else than good consequences. One example of herding. You know that example when, say, birds come to the river and none of them wants to drink the water because they are afraid of their predators. But then one bird goes to the river and drinks. And in the very short time period, we have collective effect that whole set of birds come to water and drink. So there was some spark, so to say, realized as one person in the video, who maybe stated something like you stated that it is too much to carry more than 30,000 years there, but maybe it was not stated so loudly. Maybe other persons, people involved, laughed at this one. Maybe that was some local weirdman. We can have many scenarios that maybe somebody spoke words like that before, but surely they were not implemented as a rule.
There is a rule, I think, from sociology that the institutions change or new institutions are put into force when catastrophic event happens. So it was like after the Chernobyl or something, new institutions and new rules were put in place that the same situation wouldn't happen again. So you have every time you can learn on like institutional level, you learn all your mistakes. It's really hard to change them before you come. This is also one of the reasons.
Yes, I think that is stated as using very well in somewhat less pronounced form. That population needs 5 years, approximately 5 years or so, to take into account one observable fact. So it is some less pronounced than that catastrophic event, but of course it triggers a new way of thinking. We can say about the recent crisis when it started, a lot of people were telling it will not be good. Can you imagine that, for example, you yourself come into a whole lecture with hundreds of people who said, I earned so much more, and you say, but please stop earning that, because it will bring bad consequences. But it is nice that we try to put ourselves in the position of one particular actor in one particular system, in one particular environment. Okay, so we discussed these topics. Okay, and let us, in some more formal way, treat that system again. So we have some number of here. The larger that number is, we can of course say there are approximately half males, half females. So the larger the number of deer, the larger is their annual growth. And the larger growth, automatically, larger is their total number. So one of these notions affects another in the way that it augments it. And we have closed circle, which is usually stated as feedback loop. But in situations like this, it is commonly called a vicious cycle. And that example facilitated development of more formal models, which was firstly introduced to biology and brought about ecology modeling. And during time, they were broadly applied to other disciplines. One example, formulated in 1925 and 1926, is the predator-prey model. So predator or hunter, prey, or the entity being hunted. Or Lotka-Volterra model, following the names of the scholars who formulated that model. It is written here. It has also other titles, but it is common predator-prey model, in which we have two species which live in the same environment, and the number of which influences one another. So if X denotes one species, then Y denotes the other species, and with some coefficients A, alpha, beta, gamma, and delta, we have this set of equations which govern the time development of the population of species X or Y. Dot denotes change. So in this model, y is the predator, x is the prey. And for some general set of parameters, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, we can have in time this kind of change of population of these two species. So here their number, species X, X and Y, prey and predator, are given as functions of time, and we see some oscillations occur. Or we can present the graph dependence of one species on another without explicitly taking time into account. Let us take into account this plot and just to remember what one graph, what one curve means, denotes. Let me ask this question. Is that model, the data-prey model, or what-prey model, applicable to the case of Kaiba-Dirkhardt? So is it applicable? Well, the answer is yes, it is applicable, but the main problem seemingly is that we have only deer, one species. Now, in this model, we have two species. So where is the missing species?
Yeah.
And who is the next to answer to this? Okay, deer, next one species. For that model, we need at least one more. The precise one. What is the other species?
Rules.
What?
Rules. We can...
No. Rules define the coefficients of beta lambda. Is it you? Well, in some broader model, yes, but the rules specifically rule out the things.
And then it should be some...
Yes, correct. The grass. The grass is the other species. The missing species. Yeah. So the grass is prey in this model, which seems for the moment probably paradoxical because we usually treated deer as prey for hunters, for wolves, and for other predators. While now we see that very deer who needed protection became a predator for the grass. Maybe it's not common to think about grass as another species, but it is so. So, the grass was not infinite in number. It had, remember that capacity, it had finite amount of quantity. It came year by year because of seasonal changes, but the grass, and X, the prey, denotes then the grass, has its oscillations. And we see, when there are more deer, then they eat more grass, and the total number of grass lowers, then the deer doesn't have much food, so they die. Then there is less deer, and when that is the case, the grass can grow. So we have enhancement of the quantity of grass, which repeats the cycle. So we have two connected cycles in number of populations of two interconnected species, and that are non-linear oscillations with some delay. One species depends on the other in this particular rather simple way. Yes?
Yeah, but in this projection, it's nice curves, but we saw that it's fall down quickly with the deers. Then what's happened with the grass?
Yes, you see, these are curves obtained for one particular kind of one particular set of values of these coefficients.
Uh-huh.
For some other set of alpha beta, gamma, and delta, we could have more pronounced these maxima and minima in these curves. And of course, this is model, which is very simple. These coefficients are not dependent on time, they are constant. But for example, the grass grow capacity, alpha, depends on time. It is different in summer, spring, autumn, or winter. So, of course, more detailed model will cover more details, but it will be too complicated or more complicated for interpretation. Okay, so we already answered these questions. I will not ask you these questions. Good. And just to have two rectangles which were put on the previously shown graph, just to have them here so that you can relate these two graphs. So that change in number of deer, which seemed as unique ontological change, in fact, considered from a broader point of view, is just one part of the coevolution of two species. So let us summarize some points of this presentation up to now. The model, such as predator-prey model, as we already just recently discussed, is a simplification of the whole system, and we do not expect from the particular model to cover all the details that are observable, that are documented, or that exist. We, from the model, to be treated as good model, reliable model, want just that it describes trends, observed trends, so changes in majority of species. Correctness of the model is limited in time, and that time span then influences the very meaning of that innovation. Now, there does not exist an innovation which should be good for the whole eternity. And every innovation, let us, if you know what ergodicity means, that then we can discuss that in more details. But every innovation will bring about, will spark, initiate some changes which are not wanted or which should be tried to be avoided. If we were aware of them in the moment of introduction of the first innovation. Different time intervals require different components, different treatments, different data. And interesting point, a single species can have a different roles. So the deer were first considered to be prey, and then later become predator. And a single species in some complex realistic system is in the same moment predator for some species and prey for another species. So we can have a list here. Deer is predator for grass and prey for, say, quotas and hunters. When we treat the number of deer in time, then we, in fact, enter the area of population dynamics. And for that population dynamics, for different models, we have different approaches. First, introductory considerations of population dynamics were considered by Malthus. He had some ideas which are not appropriate for the humanity, but nevertheless, from the point of view of researchers who tackle that field, he's the first known to have some in words, a spoken model. Another equation and a corresponding model is logistic equation. Here it is written, and we will see if the variable x follows that equation and fills into that model, how it evolves, how it changes in time. We will see that soon, and we will use that time change extensively. In fact, it is already here. So if one quantity any observed quantity follows that logistic equation, that it changes first. Change in a short time period is on the rise, but that it later has stabilization. Then usually we have in simplified form so-called S-curve to denote the time change of that quantity. So if you remember some data which was shown in that graph regarding to Kaibab here, we had some 4,000 in the beginning, we had number, and we still have, of 30,000, so population in thousands, as a maximum. Then, maybe that is your point in discussion. Then, optimal point of the augmentation of the number of dead deer would look something like that. We had rise in the beginning, and then when we approach the biological maximum, after implementation of new set of measures, then we would have slower and slower rise. So maybe it would go something like this, something like fluctuations around that biological. But in that case, we will not have catastrophic events. And if changes are in that way gradual, one could say optimal, then the curve denoting that changes is called S curve, and corresponding equation or simplified model which takes into account the trend is the logistic. Corresponding to that model is the rate of new quantities, which was observed previously. So if in some case this is number of deer, then this is number of newborn deer. Okay, let us for the moment forget the Kaibab deer, and let us see another example, which is scurvy eradication. So scurvy is in spring about death. It is usually known in history by sailors who during long sea voyages didn't have variety of food to eat, but just simple food, common food day by day, without vitamins and other important nutrients. And they suffered from scurvy, which caused death during many voyages of many sailors. That illness is known since ancient times, but before discovering the new world, it was not very important because the voyages themselves were not lasting long. And it was causing the scurvy, more deaths during long sea voyages than other causes, which intuitively seems very important for us, like deaths and casualties and deaths and other accidents during voyages. It is documented that in the very beginning of the 17th century, one captain experimented with lemon juice as a measure of prevention of scurvy. So, 1601. And later years brought about additional documents and reports how scurvy can be cured or avoided. But still, in, for example, 1740, during one voyage with six ships, majority of sailors died, and most of them died because of scurvy. So almost a century and a half after first proof that lemon juice is one of preventions for scurvy occurrence, we still had a lot of deaths caused by that illness. On the contrary, during that similar time, we see that in some cases, lemon juice and fruits and juices were introduced as measures to prevent scurvy, and they were tremendously successful. So, was the scurvy serious illness or not? Well, it was serious illness, but it would have been treated rather easily. Still, some more years need to pass before lemon juice, drink by sailors, was obligatory to sailors during voyages, as was prescribed for the British Navy, so for the military Navy. And it took a lot of more years before scurvy eradication measures were prescribed for the civil voyages, by civil ships and civil merchants. Altogether, it took, say, almost 2 centuries before people before introduction of these measures, which people had known. One can discuss whether this was the very beginning of that innovation to introduce lemon juice, for example, as scurvy protection measure, or it was previously stated in some other documents which we are not aware of, but that will not change our conclusion that it took too long time, more than a century, almost 2 centuries, to implement innovative measures for prevention of such death-causing illness. So why was that so? And let us discuss that in more details. So again, the question, what is the innovation in this example? I already answered the question, so I just repeated the answer. It was the introduction of lemon juice and other varieties in the nutrition of sailors that prevented occurrence of scurvy. How was that innovation communicated? Well, since 1795, it was prescribed, it was obligatory, but before that, how was it communicated?
Word of mouth.
See?
Word of mouth.
Yes. There were some written reports, but it seems that nobody took care of these reports. So probably word of mouth, which is very important fact, generally, when we treat how one innovation spreads. So word of mouth, captain by captain by captain, you're drinking in some during rest, they communicated about this introduction of lemon juice and the successfulness. What members of the system adopted that innovation? Well, it depends. After 1795, everybody was prescribed to implement this innovation, but before that, it was kept and swift. So, if sailors were happy to have one knowledgeable, innovative captain, then they leave. Otherwise, a lot of them probably suffered from scurvy. It is interesting topic to see, and it is discussed a lot in literature, so I ask you after this lecture to go to Google or other internet sources to see about these discussions. Why was introduction of scurvy protection measures so slow? There are some reasons, there is no clear answer yet, but there are some reasons which can help us to see whether implementation of some other innovations will be so slow. Okay, we have some more questions, so I think that you will get this presentation and then as your exercise treat these questions and ask them. And now let us state the second summary after second example, again one summary. We see that topics mentioned in first summary can be applicable here, but we have some additional insight. Again, here, that social importance of innovators and authority of early adopters are important in diffusion of one innovation. Maybe this word diffusion for spreading of one innovation is new, but it is the usual term describing how people, members of a system, adopt one innovation, how it spreads, how it becomes system-wide accepted. So innovation diffusion is system which lasts some time. In case of hyperpigmentation, it was almost instantaneous process, while in case of scurvy eradication, it was too slow process, very, very slow. One of the reasons is that captains and some other researchers, doctors, who wrote some first reports that lemon juice and other similar measures are good in scurvy eradication, were not very important in that time. They were monkeys. Who should listen to them? In the contrary, in the first case, the president himself stated that the measures are good. Who can then state that the measures are not good? And again, if we would like to collect data, then probably the diffusion of that innovation of lemon juice for scurvy eradication, its adoption, would look like that. And in general, that S curve denotes the number of people who adopts one in general any innovation. Well, of course, not any. There are some cases in which this curve does not reliably describe the process of innovation, but it is valid for majority of cases. People, humans, part of the system who adopt the innovation are usually divided into several groups. So first group is formed by innovators. First group is formed by innovators, and regarding the lot of innovations that we studied in innovation diffusion as a recently established field, innovators are, say, 2-3% of population, usually of high social status and of particular characteristics of themselves. So they are innovators. They have some financial means. So whether they get more or lose some financial means by the implementation, adoption of one innovation, is not catastrophic to them. They are followed by early adopters, then early majority, and after that, from that curve, we see that we reach another event. While innovators and early adopters mark the rise of the number of people who adopted innovation, and that is accelerated rise, here we have some inflection point, after which the rise continues, and it is usually, in the space of logistic equation, asymptotic rise to infinity, but it is a slower rise. And we have the last part of the population who either is not willing to adopt the population or has some other reasons why they don't adopt the innovation. One can say one can discuss whether they are lovers or losers, but that it is another case, it depends from case to case. So, now to summarize, innovation brings about some change in the system, and this change is that the system should be better adapted to its environment. That is why we introduce the change. We do not introduce the changes, take some money, effort, time, spend some money, effort, and time to introduce the changes to have worse adaptation of our system to environment. And innovation is caused, it is not the very beginning, it is caused by our previously gathered understanding of our environment. And it is interesting that this process continues after new innovation by new innovation by new innovation, so that is one continuously continuously occurring process. Every new innovation improves our adaptation to environment, improves quality of our system. Something is changed. Something is, this formulation is good improved. And that makes possible that we understand additional parts of complexity of our dynamics, which usually requires new innovation to be covered. So we have that circle continues. And from these two examples, maybe a question arose in you that how can we, in some general case, which occurs nowadays or which will occur later, how can we treat elements of the system in a proper way to see what are the species, if we are talking about species, what are other important elements, what are their relations, how they are related. Where will that delay of non-linear interaction and some non-linear consequences occur? There is no general answer to that question yet. That is on the one side why it is so interesting. But there are some partial answers, and one of them is system dynamics, which is a method that we will cover in more details now. And here we have its definition. And if I'm not wrong, we should start with coffee break now. But we had probably one non-linear interaction, because of what we will have some delay. So we will start this presentation in a few minutes and continue the discussions during coffee break. System dynamics started as industrial dynamics and was formulated, say, half a century ago by Jay Forrester, as a way to treat processes in industrial environment. But after a while, it was seen by Jay Forrester himself that the applicability of the development methodology is much broader than just description of industrial environment and processes occurring there. And it became known in system dynamics, in which case the system is general system, part of the environment, which we treat as one formulated entity, which has elements, relations among them, functions in its environment, and some attributes. Now, you realize that I didn't say system has the boundaries. It is good if we can clearly define and state boundaries of a system, but many times it is not possible. Either we do not have sufficient quantitative data, or the boundaries are so diffuse and so variable that, in fact, every treatment of the boundaries is meaningless. In case of which, we can say we have open systems, which considerably exchanges matter, energy, and information with its environment. And that exchange of matter, information, and energy between a system and its environment is in two directions. We will cover in more details graphical representation and graphical approach to system dynamics. And in order to have a clear view of graphical representation of different systems and processes, we need some basic building blocks. There are four elements of any system dynamic graph. And these elements can be denoted in different ways. Maybe you previously saw other graphical representations of different processes, which are somewhat similar, but probably some different than this graphical representation. What we will cover here consists of these four building blocks, which denotes stock, flow, converter, and connector. Stock is one quantity, anything that accumulates or drains. So, number of beer is stock. Number of fund population is stock. Amount of money is stock. Knowledge is stock. Flow denotes change. Change in the amount of stock. So it is rate of change of stock. It is rather complicated sketch for that element. It in fact consists of three elements. Flow itself is this arrow. While this circle, we will treat in more detail firstly as a separate element, a converter. It converts input data into output signal. And we will see in examples what this conversion is. Fourth element is connector, so again one type of arrow, which describes flow of information, how it passes among other groups of elements. Let us, before the coffee break, start with one example, and it will be a kind of mutual work. So the sooner we solve that problem, the sooner we will be. I hope that is motivating for you. How would we describe a number of persons in this room using system dynamics approach? Number of persons is stock. But it is not constant. Before 9 in the morning, it was different than now, and now it is different than the number of population or number of us in this room after the coffee break started. So, we are the stock, and how can we see our number or persons in this room? How can we describe all ways in which that number can change? Yeah, by flows. So we put one flow to include processes, and this number enlarges. And we put another flow describing persons living in this room to describe lowering of this. To be formal, we had to include other parts of the representation for flows. And now one can ask, what is here? What is here? Well, here and here comes environment. Other part of university, other part of Maribor. So, environment. In general, let us use a symbol of, say, some cloud to describe environment. So from environment, from outer space, people enter the room and then are counted into population of that room, or they can live, again, by going to that environment. Now, there are some spaces in this room, so if new people come, they will be welcome. But we can have cases, say, during a concert or so, when in some space, population, number of people present, is at its maximum and is not allowed to be larger. So, in general, we have, just let me remember where I put the pointer. So, in general, we obtain graph like this, which is graphical representation in system dynamics of all processes that influence the number of persons present, say, in this room. Persons, people come from environment, enter, or leave this room and again come go into environment. So these are two flows, usually called inflow and outflow. Number of persons present influences the entrance flow, because if the room is full, then that flow will be stopped, and we will not have enough flow, it will be zero. we can have additional restrictions which are imposed on the from environment to influence the number of persons present here in this room. For example, here the entrance to this room is of no cost, but we know that in many cases one should pay a ticket, for example, to come into one place, on concert, autobus, and so on. So we have a lot of restrictions. So this is rather simple representation, and this is rather simple case. And one may ask, okay, but why do we introduce all these triangles, circles, and other geometry to make simple processes complicated? Well, of course, nobody would like to use system dynamics method for to cover in details so simple processes as this number of people in this room. But this is just an introductory example to try to realize that in the complex processes, this representation will be again simple and can be stated element by element. So this is a way, in particular using a graphical representation, to treat complex systems with a myriad of elements and even more relations among them, simple by simple element, simple by simple relation. Of course, they deserve some time. And if we make errors, and we should do them, it deserves more time, it requires more time. But after a while, we obtain clear, concise graphical representation, which can then be, which is a reliable model of the system covered and discussed and analyzed, and which can be covered, which can be transformed in other means, say in the set of mathematical equations, which can be treated by a computer to obtain predictions, in this case of the number of persons, in more complicated and more important cases of other more important quantities. Okay, enough of our talk for this part. Let us then proceed with coffee break, and after that return here. So in the next minute, these flows will change. For the last 1 hour, they were zero. Now this flow will augment and make this talk of much smaller amount, while it will raise the number of people in the world. And after how much, 50 minutes, this flow will raise, and it will raise the number of persons present here. So all of you who are present, I'm glad that you came to front rows. Right? Okay. Without further comments. So there are some fundamental processes. Fundamental in the sense that in a variety of applications of system dynamics to diverse systems, we encounter similar processes. These are compounding, draining, and adjustment. What does that mean? So, compounding is one of the processes which takes into account one stock, which is raised in number and quantity by transfer from some environment. That transfer is here described as usual flow. We have some rules. We have one constant, that is flow rate, that is external constant. That external constant can be denoted in a different way than the Stokes is denoted, but let us not complicate with different geometrical elements here. And again, there is one line from Stokes to that flow, so that flow is not constant and depends on the amount of stock. So a lot of processes, nonlinear decay, exponential growth, and other processes can be described in a similar way. And here we treat the raise in stock because of the new entrances from San Juan. Now it is proper time to treat in some details this complicated representation of flow. It in fact consists of three elements. Two of them we covered previously, that is converter and that arrow for the flow itself. And the third element, this triangle, is somewhat obscure for the moment. It is in fact a valve, a bottleneck sometimes, a decision rule. So we have some requirements, some restrictions, some rules, some norms, set values and beliefs imposed by the environment or the rest of the system to that particularly treated flow. And these norms, values, beliefs and rules are converted into some formal requirements, restrictions, which channel that flow to a given interval of values. And because that prescriptions from environment are converted, then it is understandable that we have that circle, which denotes conversion, as an element of flow. And again, when these rules are converted into that prescriptions from environment into some restrictions, in mathematics there will be some coefficients in terms of equations, when they are converted, then we must have one decision, apply them, not to apply them, in what amount. And that decision rule is in fact denoted by this triangle. So flow is in fact one complex consisting of transfer of stock from one part to another, here from environment to that particular stock, with some converted impositions from environment and with some decision rules. It is usually covered by one single flow. That does not need to be covered explicitly all the times, but we should take into account that we can treat flows in a different level of detailedness. Draining is somewhat similar. The only visible difference is that the arrow denoting flow points from stock to environment. And again, we have one flow rate, external constant, which denotes the intensity of flow, which imposes the intensity of flow, and is converted in the very variable that stocks that flows from the stock to environment. And again, here described the process of draining, denotes that there is some relation between the present amount of stock and this flow. That covers the case when the flow is constant. So this connector represents zero. But also we can have other examples in which the flow itself depends on the amount of stock. And stock adjustment is some process in which we can adjust the final value of stock so that it does not raise infinite. So generic process would be also one like this, in which from environment we have flow some quantity to represent it, its emphasized value, the stock, and again transferred to environment. So that can be amount of money that we have. So by payment we get additional money, but because of our expenses and our living expenses, we lower that amount of money. Of course, we have some restrictions in these processes and so on. Here and in previous examples, we had two clouds. We have two clouds representing two environments. That is not always the case. We can have one environment. So whether these two clouds represent the same environment and can be close, or are two really two different environments that also depends on the particular case. Here is the graphical representation of the innovation process. So we see several known elements, some environments, some connectors, converters, taken as part of flows, and one stock is here emphasized as resources. We see that emphasized flow is innovation activity, which results in innovations, and we have innovation results. So a variety of processes which are naturally connected when we have one innovation, which diffuses, spreads, in other words, through environment. For this presentation, if you encounter previously this graphical approach to system dynamics, then it is very well known to you. But the experience shows that if that is your first time that you encounter such representation, then maybe you will not be very maximally efficient in applying that graphical representation. Therefore, for the rest of the presentation and also your workshop, we will use simplified notation belonging to systems thinking. So it is one part of system dynamics, introductory dynamics, in which you have smaller part of elements to be used on graphical representations. In fact, the only element is error. So, stocks are represented just by their titles. Some stock A, stock B, whatever that is. And we have error denoting link, relation between these two elements. This error means that A is the cause of B, or versa, B is the consequence of A. What kind of consequence? Well, we have an additional sign, plus or minus, to denote how A changes B. So if the arrow has plus, then raise in A raises B, while minus denotes that raising A makes B less. And further, we will use the simplified graphical representation. So we have only arrows, which denotes cause and effect relationships. With two arrows, we can obtain rather interesting structure, which is shown clearly here. Of course, usually we have A, B, C, D, E, F, G, whole alphabet of elements. But for the moment, let us think that A and B are two stocks in some general system, consisting of many other elements. Then these representations denote denotes case in which A influences B, while B same time influences A. So we have loop of influences, of relations, and that loop is called feedback loop. Some people prefer to call it feedback, some feedback loop, cause and effect relationship. There are different notions for that structure, which I will call feedback loop. And that simple loop is in fact the crucial point in the history which initiated the formulation of cybernetics as a specific discipline for governing systems by the feedback loops. Say, A are we? Of course we are A, not B. So we are A, and we want to govern some system B. Say river flow, or traffic flow, or some working of one machine, or growing of plants, whatever that B can be, and it can be anything. So we impose measures in other words, more cybernetically, we transfer mass, energy, and information to that being, and we change it. And we then observe the change of being, whether the change is as we predicted, as we wanted or desired, or something else. Whatever the change is, we document that change, we observe it, and further our actions are influenced by that observed change. After we observe change, which occurred because of our primary actions, then we impose additional actions. And that goes and circles. So we have feedback loop, which is the basic element for governing one system. When we drive a bicycle, we use our hands, to transfer energy to the rest of the bicycle, to that steel or aluminum. And we, by our eyes, by our feelings of equilibrium, observe whether the change in bicycle position is as we desired or something else. And then we impose additional actions that we additionally use efforts to roll the part of the bicycle or enhance its speed or whatever we want or use the brakes to put that wheel, the bicycle, into desired position. And we constantly, probably we are not conscious of that when we are driving, as we learned that long time ago, but we constantly impose actions and observe the changes introduced by these actions. So constantly, we as governing part of the system influence the behavior of that rest of the system and observe the changes. If we are lucky or if we are we understand the system, and the typical professor would say, if you learn the exam, then your governing actions will bring system B into desired state and hopefully make that a stationary state. If we are not so lucky or not so experienced, then the state of the part B would diverge, would change in unwanted way. Okay, so that is the basic process which occurs everywhere, all the time. For example, I am talking, so I provide you with information, different pieces of information, and I observe your change, that is observed change, so these are your answers to my questions, and by that I continue my actions. So if you answer the questions in a good, correct, complete way, then I proceed with the lecture, otherwise I repeat things. But one can say, but who is here, DA? What is the ultimate cause? See, before we answer that question, let us proceed with several other examples. Now, I will give here two examples. One is salary and performance. Performance, intensity, and quality of actions in our work, for example. So if we work well, the boss will raise our salary. So our salary is a consequence of our performance. The better the performance, the larger the salary. The larger the salary enables us to further continue our performance, to prepare better for our actions. In that sense, the larger the salary, the better the performance. One extraordinary interesting example is the case of lions in one natural habitat protected area somewhere in Africa. I am not aware of the whole details of that reference, so I urge you to use the internet to complete the reference with all the data regarding this time and place when it was documented. One interesting example is that lions in one reserved place were I really don't understand the mechanism, but it is well documented that lions established and understood that feedback loop. So the lions performed well and their salary the meat was larger. And the larger the salary, the meat, food, amount of food, the better their performance. So one interesting example of feedback loop. Of course, we have a lot of feedback loops. We don't have to take lions into account. This is just one interesting example how we can observe that cause and effect relationship everywhere. So in fact, the proper question would be, and where there are no examples of feedback loops. Another example is if we are tired, then we need sleep. The more we are tired, the more we need to sleep. The more we sleep, the less tired we are. Can I ask you for one example of feedback loop? Is there a volunteer? Okay, then we will use our breaks and further part of this presentation to think about the further examples of these feedback loops, because in fact they are everywhere. Positive feedback loop is the loop in which we have a lot of pluses. In this simple case, two elements all are pluses. In some loops with more elements, we have to have even number of minuses to have positive feedback loop. It usually denotes augmentation, amplification, and it can seem to be positive, to have positive feedback loop, that seems like a desired feedback loop. But from the point of view of stabilization of the system, of its preservation, it usually means deviation and stabilization. So if you remember that case of the Khyber deer, we had two elements, Khyber deer and growth of the population, and we had positive feedback loop, which brought about explosion, divergence, collapse, which came as consequence of that unlimited growth of population. So, is that good or bad to have positive feedback loop? And similar consideration can be applied to negative feedback loop. It usually denotes stabilization, but sometimes that denotes trivialization. Trivialization in the sense of mathematics, when trivial solution is to have zero. So when you have population zero, then it is trivial solution of some population dynamics. But of course, that is not the solution which we want. So is that good or bad to have either positive or negative feedback loop? There is no general answer. It depends what you want, what are these elements, what is the desired state. Sometimes we want negative loop to be established, feedback loop, sometimes we want positive feedback loop to be established. Let us see more examples. So equity and interest. The larger our equity in some, say, bank is, the larger is the amount of money which we get by interest. That, if it is not spent, enlarges the equity. We can have positive feedback loop with more than two elements, with 3, 4, 5, 6 elements. Number of elements in feedback loop is not limited. So the larger the time we spend at work, more fatigue we feel. And if we work with larger fatigue, we make a larger number of mistakes. And the larger the number of mistakes is, we need more time to spend at work to perform some job. So it is, again, undesired positive feedback loop, which is sad. There are examples, so I think they are all self-understood. If we have demand for one product, then simple consequence is to raise its price. So larger the demand is, the larger the price. But the larger the price, the lesser the which is in fact good, otherwise the price would always rise without limit. Of course, it depends who we are. If we are people who demand something, then we are going to have a negative feedback loop. If we take advantage of the price, well, it is, say, our profit, then we don't really like to have that negative feedback. Again, one simple example. So we see that many elements, many our common states, many our characteristics are simply related. Let us see one somewhat more complicated example of our biosphere. So the part of Earth. To see another element and that are nested feedback loops, which means that we don't have to have only a single feedback loop consisting of different number of elements, but we can have more feedback loops. Here we see several feedback loops. That is one example taken from internet sources. So we see that sunshine influence, or more formally, amount of solar radiation influences, for example, Earth's temperature, evaporation from Earth. There are other elements of biosphere related to that. We have clouds, rain, amount of water. They are all related. In a way, this number of relations, large number of arrows, seems that the system is complicated. But in fact, with this graphical representation, we can easily proceed further and analyze how change, because of whatever reason there can be, change in one element, in what sequence and in what amount influences other elements. So that is the starting point, that result of system thinking, for further, more detailed analysis of any system. Here the particular feedback loops, and they are usually denoted by this almost closed circle, with plus or minus denoting negative or positive feedback loop, are consisting of the following elements. So clouds, sunshine, Earth's temperature. Then clouds, rain, amount of water, evaporation, and clouds, forming this positive feedback loop. And we have one simple feedback loop consisting of two elements, negative feedback loop, the elements being evaporation and the amount of water. Here is one more complicated example of the number of population of Earth. And it is one of the early and rather important applications of system dynamics. Can we somehow understand the processes influencing the number of population of us on Earth? And we can, but of course it is not trivialized in a reliable, at a reliable level. It consists of a lot of mutually connected elements. Let us now discuss in some more words that relation of cause and effect. So A and B, whatever the A is, whatever the B is. I was previously speaking about that, treating that as a cause and that as a consequence or the effect. But since we have two-way relationship, then that effect causes the cause. So maybe then we should have interchange their meanings so that in fact effect is treated as cause, and cause in fact being the effect. So what is the proper then solution? Is this really the cause and then the effect, or vice versa?
What is the answer?
they are mutually connected on equal footings. But every model, you remember that first summary, or it was the second summary. Every model has time span in which it is applicable, while in some broader time span, it is not so applicable, or at least it has to be enhanced with additional elements. So in a short time scale, really, from hen we get the egg, or from egg we get the hen. In a broader time span, but on evolutionary time scales, we need other elements with which then resolve the question what was the first, and the answer is, I think, that neither hen nor egg was the first, but some other species which developed in different way. So, on the time scale which we have in question, when we present such a relationship between two elements, then in fact we have the case that one element influences itself. All elements can be causes, all elements can be effects, and that is the one simple truth which in fact many times by decision makers in simplified applications is neglected. We treat just one element as a cause and proceed just with lines, the arrows representing relationship to the element which we need to change, and we say, okay, that is the only change that will occur in the system. We will influence the cause, and as a result, another element, the effect, will be changed in a way which we want. Of course, that's not the case. Maybe that is the first time being realized in the ecological modeling, but it is generally the case in the system. Whatever element we change, surely, as a rule, all other elements will be changed, somewhat in a desired way, some in non-desired way, some in short-term scale, some in large-term scale. And it is good to have one approach like system dynamics to cover all changes simultaneously to see whether the desired change is majority of changes or not, or minority. Okay. Now, let us start with two introductory cases, which you will, for the first several minutes, treat in some details separately, and then we will discuss these two examples and proceed with one exercise. Since here are eight of listeners, eight of participants of this summer school, or more. So, eight, okay. Then, please group yourself into two groups. Group yourself into two groups and discuss the first example, discuss the first topic. Consider one aircraft flying and discuss what mass it transfers, what energy it transfers, and what information it transfers during this flight.
We thought about the environment, and we said that the environment gives information to the crew, which also receives information from the tower and passes it on to the aircraft.
is one system in its environment. The environment consisting of natural part, atmosphere, and human part, some stations which provides information. And you further divide the aircraft into its parts. Probably here are some engines. And you all consider there are some passengers, which is not always the case. Of course, we can have only crew, which in aircraft travels without passenger, transport aircraft without passengers, or military aircraft without passengers. So we can have a variety of aircrafts. Okay, you took aircraft for passengers. And you concentrated on the aircraft as a system in a specific state, which is not equilibrium state, but which can be stationary state. By stationary state, I mean the whole separate aircraft is flying. I doesn't mean at the stationary level. It can change and it changes its flight level, its direction, its speed. But anyway, it is all the time aircraft in the air. That being the stationary case. Okay, so we have system in one stationary state, which is not equilibrium one. Equilibrium here is trivial equilibrium, in which the aircraft is on the ground, ALG. So we need constant flow of energy between aircraft and environment to preserve the aircraft in that particular state. During its flight, its engines constantly spend that fuel and energy content in it, while previously, of course, before the flight, or in some particular cases during the flight, and the fuel during the flight, we can have that that other direction of energy flow from environment to the aircraft. Okay, I am sure that you would all formulate this system with this energy flow between aircraft. Information flow within aircraft, if there are passengers, or among the crew, if it consists of more than one people, and information flow between aircraft, in particular this crew, and the rest of the environment, in particular human stations, radio operators, and so on. And the mass flow itself is, in this case, related to energy consumption and the mass of fuel and fuel spent and products of burning the fuel which are released into atmosphere. So that is one approach in which the aircraft is in stationary state considered during flight. Another approach is that aircraft is one part of the larger system, but in a particular way in which aircraft itself makes the flow. So we can equate the aircraft with the flow. In which case the elements connected with that flow are two cities, one from each aircraft departure and another one in which the aircraft will land. And then aircraft is the realization of flow of mass, whether that mass is the mass of passengers or some other weight. And energy and information depending on the particular type of aircraft and its purpose of flight. So in this example we see that in general case every system can be treated as consisting of its elements with its relations, or it can be one element of one larger system. Okay, now let us consider similarly, the second example. So discuss, please, flow or transfers of mass, energy, and information during this lecture. So take several minutes.
Then
you'll be transferring
information back to you.
Oh, I'm going to do that. case very profoundly. So just let us sketch to summarize that. So we have lecturer and we have auditorium. So you are direct. And let it be seen better. So I constantly provide you with some information. You give me feedback. How I obtain your feedback? That is also one information flow. Through your questions, comments, and answers of my questions, and by looking at you. If you use mobile phones, newspapers, then definitely this lecture is not going in good direction. But if you follow the presentation in a very concentrated way, then it is good, that part of information flow. Of course, I had some expectations. So expectations by lecturer influences my flow of information, influences my state, whether I will talk fast or slowly, whether I will cover some basic elements for a rather long time, or whether I will skip the basic elements. So I have expectations. How I obtained these expectations? By asking Ms. Carolina and other colleagues about you something, about your level of study, your disciplines that you study, and during coffee breaks and other informal talk, I try to figure out about your interests. You also have expectations. So if my information flow is aligned with your expectations, then as a consequence, in this part, I will get information as one set of consequences that you are interested, that you cooperate, that you follow the presentations. But if there is significant discrepancy between, say, my expectations about you and your true state, then after this flow, the result is that I will see that you are not interested. And vice versa. If your expectations are aligned with that what I will talk about, good, your interest will be high, motivation preserved, cooperation in that feedback loop established. Otherwise, if there is large discrepancy, for example, if you came here thinking that I will talk about, say, how to predict football results, and I talk about scurvy several centuries ago, then your expectations will be completely different from the flow of information with which I provide you. So we have expectations, which gives us the context, and along with that, the two elements, the auditorium and the lecturer, we have from the environment facilities like this. Facilities for presentation, which helps me to transfer you information. We have some requirements from environment that we have to be that we have to finish soon, not so soon. Okay. And is there something missing? We have one relationship. Remember that loop that. That a single element can be cause and effect. So you as the auditorium are not a single element. You have your inner structure. For this level, it is not so important, but you have your means for communication quietly or loudly during coffee breaks, which is another information flow by which you align yourself and your expectations. So, in this simple lecture room, we have a lot of relationships among rather small number of elements. Okay, let us now proceed with the exercise. work in groups and follow these points. So choose one system, present its system thinking diagram. If there will be time, then suggest an innovation in that system and analyze the consequences of that innovation. Now, maybe that can be simplified in a way so that we all arrange that both groups consider the same system. Do you agree? Do you have one suggestion? Several of them, so that we won't work each of them. What system can be treated by these points? One example would be to take one system treated in the previous examples, because then we already almost solve the first part and almost have the second part. So that we proceed with the third and fourth part. Another approach would be to take a completely new system.
During this small amount of time, we will not see full set.
groups, one of the, so the professor will be asking the audience in the web streaming, and one of the audience, like us tweeting, or to the outside, and then we could communicate it to you, like through questions or comments.
Yes. But just let me ask you several questions. What improvement in this lecture will be introduced by including other people? See, you can give me enough of feedback. Do we need other people who will be your representatives?
I would say that from my point of view, maybe you would be more motivated because your audience would be broader. And if you think that you're spreading like good knowledge, it's more people can hear you.
Yeah,
and more people can get it from the source. And not only people that can hear physically can get it.
This is an interesting point, because then you have to define more clearly the lecture or the study, so that you see what is the target, say, what is the desired state. If the lecture wants more people to listen, then clearly this is the case. But maybe the lecture doesn't care how many people listen, but cares whether they listen concentrated in a concentrated way, carefully, or are just physically present, but psychically who knows where. I prefer the other part, yes. That you know, it doesn't matter how many of you are here, as long as present of you are concentrated here. Do you have questions for each other? And your intuition? Let me then ask you that introduction of video tips. How would that improve the lecture process? What part of it?
It's already halfway in, you know, like at the half, at the half point of the lecture, and everybody, you know, like when, okay, I'll just be plain honest, like at, in most lectures, not this one, I'm not referring to this one. You know, at the half point you're sort of like, you know, you're not there anymore. So by introducing video, you could have like increased concentration of the students. So, like, it'd be like, wow, you know, something different. I don't know, but then also like that's referring to your question. But that wasn't like our intention. Our intention was to improve, like if we were studying cases like this, you know, like, looking at the feedback cycles and stuff like that. This is,
I cannot describe everything by words. I cannot make a sketch of everything, and still photographs are not sufficient for it.
Yes.
So I just wanted to
listen.
Okay, if you have questions between each other of your groups or between the groups, then we will continue on the march. So that ends my lecture for today.